We want to welcome everyone as we gather this morning for praise and worship, and as we just seek after God, and hopefully as we just listen to how God might be speaking to our hearts. You know, we're living in a world with a lot of chaos and craziness, and the one thing we can know as we gather is we serve a God who is faithful and who is good and who will be victorious in the midst of everything, and so we just turn to Him in faith. As we look at our announcements this week, generally speaking, everything is mostly the same in terms of small groups are all continuing on. A couple of change, extra things. Wednesday from 5 to 8 p.m. is a fundraiser at Pizza Ranch for free ministry, which is provides books for prisoners. So if you're not doing anything on Wednesday night, you like, well, you could say pizza or fried chicken. I think their chicken is better than their pizza. But that's my opinion, you know. Yeah. So I go to Pizza Ranch for the chicken and then have a little pizza on the side. But that's another story, right? So that's, what is it, a percentage, I assume, that goes, Terry? A percentage that'll go to a free book ministry? From 5 to 8 p.m. And the Saturday group, we canceled last minute because we had too many people that were going to be missing. So we won't be on Romans 13. We'll be on Romans 12 this coming Saturday. And the other thing is there is some flyers on the front table for Right Now Media. If you're not familiar with Right Now Media, it's a free free resource to you that's being provided by an anonymous donor. With all sorts of Bible study resources that's you can benefit from on your study at home. So you can grab a flyer or scan a code and get connected to that. The other thing is we're coming into the summer months, so if you have interest in game nights or cookouts like we've done some in the past, you know, mark it on your communication card, let us know, and we'll try to get some of those scheduled over the upcoming months. So I think with that, that's enough announcements. Let's get to the important stuff, right? So let's pray and go to God in some worship and praise. Oh, glorious Lord, we just come before your throne today, and we do recognize the sinfulness of man. We recognize just how crazy our world is, and the reality is our world has been crazy throughout all of history. It's just a matter of what degree and who's involved and just... There's so many things that so often distract us from you and just what you have done for us through Christ. And we pray that as we come in this day, in this time, that you would just help us to really focus our hearts upon coming before you in worship, that you'd help us to focus on what has been done for us through the cross, through the death and the resurrection of Jesus, and that you would just help us to really reflect upon what does it mean to be faithful to you in our day and age, and a world that there is so many politics at play, when there are nations at war, in a time when there's just a lot of political correctness that is just completely oblivious to science. We just ask that you would help us to continue to be a bright light for Christ, and that you would, as we come to the various crossroads in life where we have to decide whether we will please men or please you, that you would just give us the motivation and the courage and the stamina to say we must obey God rather than man. Father, we just ask that you would just sink that into the depths of our hearts, that you would be first and foremost, that we would seek first you and your kingdom, and that we would just continue to be faithful to burn brightly with the light of Christ as we come in the name of the one who's taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, I'm going to be reading some parts of Psalm 62 and some parts of Psalm 63 this morning. So if you wanted to catch those, that's where I am. So Psalm 62 first. I waited quietly before God, for my victory comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress where I will never be shaken. Let all that I am wait quietly before God, for my hope is in him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress where I will not be shaken. My victory and honor come from God alone. He is my refuge, a rock where no enemy can reach me. O my people, trust in him at all times. Pour out your heart to him, for God is our refuge. We come together today to pour out our hearts in praise to the one who has given his life so that ours might be saved. Would you please stand as you are able? We're going to start with our clappy song from last week, Graves into Gardens.
Along.
God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon your power and glory. We continue on with I Belong. Just who we belong to is the King of Kings.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope. From
Our scripture reading today is from the book of Luke, chapter 12, verse 49 through verse 59. I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it were already kindled. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to give peace on earth? No. I tell you, but rather division. For from now on, in one house, there will be five divided, three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He also said to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you say at once, a shower is coming, and so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be a scorching heat, and it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? And why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? As you go with your accuser before the magistrate, make an effort not to settle with him on the way, lest he drag you to the judge, and the judge hand you over to the officer, and the officer put you in prison. I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the very last penny. May God bless the reading and hearing of his word, and may God bless Pastor Dan's message.
I think we'll just start with today. You know, there are some texts of Scripture that are more fun to teach than other texts of Scripture. But the reality is we have to deal with all the texts of Scripture, right? Because we need to look at the totality of truth and not just the parts of it that we like. And part of those get into the element of the reality of judgment. And so obviously we're going to have to deal with some of that today. You know, over the course of life, we're constantly making decisions. So, for instance, you know, you're here today because you chose this morning to come to church. You know, some are tuning in online, and they're tuning online because they chose to tune on in line. You know, some of you chose to sit in the front row. You are such a good student, right? Some of you chose to sit in the back row. Well, you know, we won't say anything about back rows, right? But, you know, there are so many decisions that we make, consciously or unconsciously. And many decisions that we make are inconsequential, right? They're really no big deal, You know, many of you are going to be battling with, where am I going to eat after church today? Not really a big deal, right? And sometimes it's these decisions that aren't really big deals that we make a lot more, put a lot more weight on than they really deserve, and we get anxious over them and so on and so forth. But there are many decisions that are really nothing major, right? And we just kind of go through it each day, and we don't even think about the fact that we're making a choice. However, life will also bring us to crossroads that create crisis points, when the decision you make will have a major impact on your life, determining the direction you go, the consequences you'll experience, and even to a degree, who you'll become. So say, for instance, the person you choose to marry. Pretty consequential decision, wouldn't you say? Or the path that you choose to travel. And you know, and many there are these crossroad moments, these crisis points, where the choices you make today are going to shape your tomorrows. And the problem when you come to a crossroad is it requires a choice because you can't go in two directions at one time. You know, I'm a twin, and I can't even do that, right? You can't go in two directions at the same time. And it's not always clear which direction to go. And that's what leaves you with the crisis, right? Which direction? Now, some of you have heard some of this information before, but it just is it's a good way to illustrate the idea of crossroads. My junior year of college, I had just been accepted to an internship at State Farm when I could say I began feeling called into ministry. I might say I began feeling pushed into ministry, you know, by God, right? Not by others, right? But, you know, because he kind of brought me kicking and screaming, right? Was feeling and I was kicking and screaming the whole way, right? So my junior year of college was when this kind of happened. I'd already been accepted to an internship at State Farm, and this was a crisis point, right? Because it would shape years to come. I could follow the path that I'd been pursuing, computers, math, State Farm, or I could pursue the path that I said I would never take. And Amanda and I, at that point, we'd already decided to get married that summer, knowing that I had this internship at State Farm that I think paid more per hour than my mom was getting paid after working 20 years, right? So we had decided to get married, knowing that I had this internship lined up, that would get my foot in State Farm, and, you know, likely a job afterwards. And when we began thinking about feeling called into ministry, that left that in question. Because we're like, well, you know, there's no guarantees. And whichever choice I would make would have a big impact and a cost. Accepting the internship, making good money with the likelihood of a good job at State Farm would allow us to get married. But what's the cost? I would have wondered, am I being faithful to God? Am I following the path that God has for me? And for me, that would have been a very significant cost, right? Because while I had always said that I would never be a pastor, the most important thing in my life was God and my faith, right? Or could turn down the internship to explore God's calling. You guys can probably guess which one I ended up doing, right? To explore. Don't ruin it. I won't give you any spoilers, right? I could turn down the internship to explore God's calling with no guarantee of a job beyond the summer and the probability of needing to postpone getting married, because when we made the decision, that's what we thought we were also doing. Incidentally, that's not what happened. It's just what we thought at the time. God provided in ways we didn't expect. I would have the uncertainty of a future, you know, because we wouldn't have the ability to provide, you know, and so on and so forth. But what I would have was I would have peace knowing that I was being faithful to God and that I was at peace with God and that I would come out with some kind of clarity in terms of what God's direction was in life. Now, I share this because I want us to understand that my clicker is not working. It's on here. There we go. Every choice comes with a cost. Now, whether it's material, whether it's spiritual, whether it's emotional, I don't want you to think of cost just in terms of dollars and cents, but every choice comes with a cost, and it's a matter of whether you pay now or whether you pay later and what you pay in the end. Now, another crossroads that we kind of faced would come in 2008. I had comfortably been serving at Colfax and Aerosmith at that point for 12 years. Things were going well. I knew what I was doing, or at least I thought I did, right? I knew what was expected of me. I knew where the next paycheck was coming from. I knew what the people were like. I knew what the communities were like, which I served. But Amanda and I, we did this crazy thing of committing to pray about starting a new church in a community that we did not know, which would start with only Amanda, Hannah, and I, where provision would be less certain, and I really didn't know what I was doing, let alone how I would get it done. And here's Network. What we knew was that we were at a crossroads, and we could choose what was comfortable or to follow how we believed God would be leading. Now, one choice would have left us in Colfax, where who knows what the future would have been like. Only God does. The other brought us to Bloomington, where we now have Network and all the blessings that come with that. You know, sometimes when we come to a crossroads, the costs aren't always clear. And we didn't know along the journey some of the costs we would experience, but neither did we realize the blessings that it would bring, such as getting to know each of you and the blessing that Network's been. But we come to a variety of crossroads in life, which confront us with these crisis points which determine the direction we're going to go. And I shared two illustrations from my own life, but only to get to this point. None of the other crossroads that we face are as important as how you respond to Jesus. This is the most pivotal of the crossroads you'll experience in life, as how am I going to respond to Jesus. Now, 2 weeks ago, we celebrated Easter with the proclamation that he is risen. And last week, Jesus taught us that we must be ready. By Jesus taught us, I'm saying what we were taught in his word from the lesson of that day, right? I don't have a messianic complex, so I just thought about how that might sound. Last week, we learned how we must be ready and stay ready for his return. And our state of readiness determines either reward or loss. And when you think about it, Jesus is coming, his message, his works, they confront us with a crisis point, a moment of decision, and that is, will you believe and follow, right? When he returns, will you be found ready? And there is no greater crossroads that you will come to. There's no greater crisis point that will shape not only the direction of your life, but your eternal destiny than whether or not you put your faith in Jesus. Now, I'm going to add in this next little line. That is, if it's true. Now, there's a reason why I'm adding that in, right? Because truth is not determined by what you believe. But what you believe can have grave cost if it's not based on what is true. Do you think there are people today that believe things that aren't true? How many genders are there on Facebook these days? Are there people that believe things that aren't true today? All sorts of, you know, just because you believe something doesn't make it true. But what you believe can have grave cost if it's not based on what's true. Think about the damage that's being done in the name of political correctness. Think about the damage that's being done because people are buying into things that aren't true. You know, Jesus is the greatest crossroads you're going to come to, right? Now, we need to ask the question if it's true, right? And obviously, I'm here because there's a lot of evidence, right? And there's a lot of reason to believe it is true. And this is what's at the heart of verses 54 through 56 when Jesus says, where he brings it to, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? Why is it that you cannot see the truth that's right before your eyes? And as I was thinking and reflecting on this text, one of the things that just kind of struck my heart is part of it, is it because they're listening to people who are always telling them what to think and not how to think? People who are always telling them what to think and not how to think. How to see the truth that's right before their eyes. Why do you not know how to discern what is true? And when Jesus says, why do you not know how to interpret the present time? Here's the other part that I thought we need to stay on this, especially in light of last week's events. Jesus is not calling us to be enraptured with the rapture and to read into earthquakes and solar eclipses that it's time to pack our bags. Because, you know, when he says, why do you not know how to interpret the present time? You know, the present time was his time. He's referring here to his first coming. Why can't you look at all the evidence, all the works, all the things that are taking place before your eyes and recognize what they mean? Because last week we learned about when it comes to a second coming, it's going to be what? Unannounced on a day and hour that we do not expect or know. I've got to. I'm sorry. You know, what you believe doesn't make something true. Did anybody hear, and I'm going to be good, I'm not going to mention names, right? But did you know that the cicadas coming out is an evidence of climate change? Did you know that earthquakes were evidence of climate change? Did you know that solar eclipses were evidence of climate change? And this is being promoted on our news. Do you know that there's always been solar eclipses? You know the cicadas have been around for a while, cicadas, right? No, I'm saying that they said it really funny on the, cicadas. Yeah, that I was trying to think of how it was said. You know, people are being told what to think. They're not being told how to think. And they're buying into all sorts of propaganda that's causing all sorts of damage. Jesus says, why can't you interpret the present time? That's just as true for us as it is for them in their day and age. And Jesus is saying, why can't you see the truth that's right before your eyes? Now, Edwards comments, and I quote, the Greek word here for time, kairos, does not refer to time as duration, but to time as opportunity. And when we're looking at the text here, they're at a crossroads. They're at a crisis point, and that is, what will we believe about Jesus? Is he who he claims to be or not? And Jesus calls them hypocrites, revealing that their sin was not one of simple but of willful ignorance. Because his teaching, his life, his miracles, they all provide sufficient and ample evidence pointing to him as the Messiah and that in him the kingdom of God was present. But it's difficult to interpret the present time if you ignore everything that challenges your interpretation. And so God is at work in Jesus, but they're refusing to see what's right before their eyes. So verse 57, he says, and why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? It comes back down to you're allowing others to tell you what to think rather than learning how to think. You know, I told Rich this morning, I said, it's hard for me to read the scriptures anymore without thinking about connections with what's going on in our world today and how crazy it's all become. I try to be very good at towing the line of not becoming political, but giving you illustrations to illustrate the point, right? Because that's what I want to do. I want to illustrate the point without going over and above. I don't promise that I always toe the line very well. But I do love a line from Dave Ramsey. And I remember this from when I was teaching the financial peace classes. And this was a line that just always stuck with me. It's when he said, you know, there's nothing as uncommon as common sense. There's nothing as uncommon as common sense. And because what Jesus is effectively saying is, why aren't you using some common sense? Don't simply believe my words. Believe my works because the truth is right before your eyes. He gives that argument in John 10, 25 through 38. And what he says is, weigh what I say in light of what I do and the fruit that it bears. He said, don't just take my word for it when I say that I'm the Messiah. Take a look at what I'm doing. Does it align with the Messiah? Take a look at the fruit that I'm bearing. Recognize this moment before it's too late. And that's where verses 57 through 59 are going to come into when it talks about settle accounts before you come to the judge. Settle accounts before it's too late. Because there's nothing more important than your relationship with God. Now, we can talk a lot about politics. We can talk a lot about policies. We can talk a lot about what's going on in the world around us. We can talk a lot about what's going on in your personal lives, right? But what's the most vital question? That is your relationship with God. Because in the end, that's the only one that really matters. Isn't it? In the end, that's the one that really matters. Now, it's getting just a little heavy in here. So I want to lighten it up for just a moment. So I'm going to give you two words, and you can feel free to call out the first thing that comes to mind if you think you know what I mean. All right? So I'm just going to give you two words. Shut up. Some of you are thinking, yeah, Dan, I wish you'd shut up, right? But think about these two words, shut up. Think about how we use those words, right? So primarily, I'm thinking the first thing that probably comes to mind is stop talking, right? But how else can shut up be used? Close, right? Shut up the house. Shut up the car doors. Or, you know, crazy people, you know, crazy way we use language to shut up. Has a very different meaning, doesn't it? Same two words, right? But if you take them out of any context, then, boy, you can twist language for whatever you want. How about if I just use two words of bring up? What do you think I'm talking about? Announce. You can bring up a topic. You can bring up a child in the way they should go. You can bring up software. Unless it's Microsoft, then it'll crash on you, right? I'm sorry. Or how about this one? You could bring up last night's dinner. Right? So same two words, right? Same two words can be used in a variety of different ways. Yeah. Well, very good, Don, right? Because I could bring up last night's dinner and then I can talk to you about, hey, this is what I had last night, or I can give you a visual display of what I had last night, right? I should have never played this game, right? All right, I've got one more set of two words for you. How about under fire? A soldier being shot at. Verbal attack. Being held responsible for something. Being intensely questioned. Being intensely challenged. Being canceled. How about being under great pressure to make a decision? I'm just under the fire. I've got to make something work here, right? Isn't it interesting? Same two words, right, can have a wide variety of different meanings depending on the context and how it's being used. So, okay, that was a fun experiment, but we're here to learn, and we should be about religious things, and we have a text to get back to, right? So let's play this game now. What's the first thing that comes to mind when you think about why did Jesus come? Forgiveness? What was that? Obedience? Die on the cross? Truth? So we can come to God? So reconciliation, restoration? Okay. Salvation? To spread God's word? Okay. So we think about why did Jesus come? Really, we can get various nuances of why Jesus came, right? We can talk about, well, he came to seek and save the lost. He came to die for our sins. He came that we could be reconciled or restored to the Father. You might even think of, by golly, you might even think of scripture verses to validate your thoughts, right? So like, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many, Mark 10:45. You know, many of these thoughts and the things that I heard you kind of articulating fits with the image of Jesus as our shepherd, Jesus blessing the children, Jesus as the friend of sinners. Considering we just celebrated his death and resurrection, we also have the image of Jesus as our Passover lamb. And generally, we think of Jesus and we think of terms like compassion and mercy and grace and forgiveness and tenderness. And all these things are true, but are they the totality of who he is? You know who the Passover lamb is also? The Lion of the tribe of Judah. Now, isn't that an interesting contrast? The Passover lamb who's also the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Now, why is it critical that they know how to interpret the present time? Because Jesus says, hey, you know, the purpose of my coming, because there's one that I didn't hear you mention. It's the one that we actually read most recently. So that's the effect of his coming. Right? When he talks about the division, this is the effect it will have. But what's the very first verse that we read? to cast fire on the earth. I didn't hear any of you mention that purpose with Jesus coming. But Jesus mentions it, doesn't he? So he came both to seek and to save the lost, but also to cast fire on the earth. Isn't that interesting? It's probably not the first image that you think of when you think of Jesus, right? Most of us will jump more to verse 50, right, when he says, I have a baptism that I need to undergo, which refers to, you know, his crucifixion, his death, that all the suffering he's going to go through for us, right, as a metaphor for suffering and death. But Jesus also said, I came to cast fire on the earth. Now I'm kind of feeling under fire because scholars posit a variety of interpretations for what that phrase means. Honestly, I probably had 5 minutes of content here that I've narrowed down to this, okay? Judgment, purification, the Holy Spirit, discord and contention, spiritual fervor, and the gospel. I read a variety of different commentaries that all came and said, this is what Jesus meant by it came to cast fire on the earth, right? And they all lumped all these things under that category. So you might ask the question, well, which is it? Well, any and all of them can be argued from the scripture as a whole. The question is what is Jesus teaching in this particular text at this particular time? Now, fire predominantly was used as a metaphor for judgment as well as for purification. And really, when you think about judgment or purification, the effect is the same, right? Both lead to what? Division. Where does Jesus take us in the next verses? People will be divided over me, right? Judgment, purification, they both have the same effect. There's a division, right? Whether you're talking about dividing the righteous from the unrighteous or whether you're talking about dividing the pure from the impure, I came to cast fire on earth. Jesus says, the world's going to be divided over me. And part of judgment is to purify by dividing out impurities, right? So in this case, to divide out those who properly interpret the signs of his coming, verses 54 through 56, so as to be reconciled and have accounts settled prior to the judgment, verses 57 through 59, because you recognize who Jesus is. You know, the person that divides our calendar, think about it. B.C., A.D., right? His birth divides our calendar. He had such an impact on the world around us, right? There's nothing more important than to think about how have we responded to him. And what he's teaching in this text is people are divided over Jesus now, and in the judgment they'll be divided by their response to Jesus. In Jesus, we have the intersection of the Old Testament that's looking forward, right? We have all the prophecies, we have all the covenants, we have all these things that look forward to Jesus in the Old Testament. And the New Testament, it reflects back on him, right? His life, his death, his resurrection, and the birth of the church and so on, and as it looks back to Jesus. And the other thing we have at this intersection is we have the world that's forever changed by him. Do you know any other person in history that changed our calendar? Right? Nobody could deny the impact that he's made on the world around. Well, I mean, they can. It just, you know, just because you believe something doesn't make it true. Of all the crossroads we come to, there's nothing more important than how we respond to Jesus. Because Jesus either is or he isn't who he claimed to be. He either rose from the dead or didn't, and he either will return or he won't. But none of that depends on what I believe. All of it depends on what is true. And the problem we have in our culture is we've bought into my truth and your truth, which distracts us from seeking the truth. Right? So verses 56 and 57 again. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? And why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? All of that implies that there can be and there is a distinction between my truth and the truth. And the goal is what? The goal is to allow the truth to define and determine what my truth is. But that's not how we use it in our culture, is it? G.K. Chesterton wrote, I was listening to a podcast, and they quoted this Chesterton on this quote, and I thought, hey, that might work in my sermon. It says, when men choose not to believe in God, they do not then thereafter believe in nothing. They then become capable of believing anything. Doesn't that sound like our culture today? Oh, thank you. I had believed that I was where I should be on my PowerPoints. But what you believe doesn't make something true, does it? You know, when we consider the impact Jesus has made on the world, the evidence that we have for the resurrection, because there are many arguments for the resurrection, which is a whole sermon in itself. Actually, it makes books, whole books have been written about it. When we think about all the evidence we have for the trustworthiness of Scripture, when we have the fulfilled prophecies, well, we have a foundation for faith and to trust what Jesus has done for us. And knowing how to interpret the present time for us is knowing how to interpret the evidence that testifies to Jesus, which culminates, of course, in his death and resurrection. He says, I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it would have that it were already kindled. Jesus is longing for the completion of his mission, which at that time was incomplete, right? Verse 50 goes into what that mission is. I have a baptism to undergo. And that baptism refers to his death, his suffering and death. Jesus came not only to teach the word of God, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out demons, to feed the multitudes. He did all these things, but that wasn't the reason for which he came. He came to take upon himself the judgment that we deserved. In fact, that language of baptism, it draws from allusions to from the Old Testament. And Powell and other scholars point out that the language of baptism here is to be interpreted in terms of, and I quote, the inundation of the waters of divine judgment. Jesus announces that he will be uniquely inundated with God's judgment. Jesus came to deal with the problem of sin and our need for a Savior. And he says, how great is my distress, right? Because you know what Jesus knew at this point? He knew that life was taking him to the cross. And you know what Jesus had in the Garden of Gethsemane? He had a crossroads moment. I think one of the, I don't remember who it was, but when we said, what do you think of with Jesus? Part of it, somebody said obedience, right? In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus had a crossroad moment, right? He says, if it be possible, take this cup from me. Another reference to the suffering and death he was going to endure. And he says, but not my will, but your will be done. That's a crossroad moment, isn't it? That's a choosing. I can't go two directions at once. It's my will or it's God's will. That's a crossroad moment. He says, how great is my distress? Because this has seized his thoughts. In fact, the root of the word has that idea of seized. It seized his thoughts. He's preoccupied with the path because he knows exactly where this mission is taking him. And it's taking him directly to the cross where he would be inundated with the judgment of God that we deserved. If you remember the angel's announcement surrounding Jesus' conception and birth in Matthew 1:21, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. At his birth, in Luke 2:10 through 14, the angel says, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which implies we needed saving, right? And then the text goes on, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those whom he has pleased, because he took our judgment so that we can be reconciled and that we could be at peace with God. So what do we make of verses 51 through 53? Well, I came to cast fire, right? Do you think that I've come to give peace on the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. And then it goes on, two will be divided against three and three against two. You know, Jesus came to bring peace with God, but peace with God does not equate to peace with everyone else, does it? Jesus didn't promote peace at all costs, but peace with God, whatever the cost. Even if that cost was those closest to you, because he said, people are going to be divided over me. Because people are divided over truth. I came to cast fire on the earth. People will be divided. Why? Because truth divides. Truth divides what's true from what is false. There will be some who will recognize him for who he is and others who will not. And of all the crossroads that we come to, of all the crisis points we experience, there's none more important than how do we respond to Jesus? What do we believe about him? Because every choice comes with the cost that must be weighed in light of the benefit. And choosing Jesus might at times put you at odds with others. But it will bring you peace with God. Rejecting Jesus may give you peace with others, but it will leave you at odds with God. It's basically what he's teaching us. Because in a world in conflict with God, we have to choose. And it's the same choice that the disciples had when they were told by the authorities to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. What did they say? We must obey God rather than men. And our text today that looks like, why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? Why do you not judge for yourselves who is the ultimate authority, right? Is it God or is it man? Now, that question leads into the parable that illustrates the need to come to a decision before it's too late in verses 58 and 59. As you go with your accuser before the magistrate, now let's just ask this question. As you go with your accuser, who's the accuser representing here? In this case, it's Jesus. Now think about, as you go with your accuser before the magistrate, you see, right, this is the importance of language. This is an image we don't normally think of because Satan is the accuser, right? To be fair to man, Satan is the accuser. But as you go with your accuser before the magistrate, make an effort to settle with him, right? So we're not settling with Satan, we're settling with Jesus. We got to have the rest of the text, right? Lest he drag you to the judge, and the judge hand you over to the officer, and the officer put you in prison. I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the very last penny. So the present time is being presented as the time going with your accuser before the magistrate, and as the time of opportunity to settle on the way before judgment is rendered. Right? The point of the parable is be reconciled with God while there's time. Now Sproul writes, and I quote, he says, Jesus takes a very ordinary situation and applies it to his situation with the people. The judge is obviously God, and the adversaries are obviously Jesus and those who are standing in opposition to Jesus. Jesus' message to his contemporaries is this: look, I am here. We are discussing my identity, your allegiance. Let's settle this issue now. We are opponents, and we are heading to the court. But my Father is the judge, and if you don't settle with me outside the court, then the judge is going to throw the book at you. He will turn you over to the constable, and the constable will throw you into prison. Jesus pleads with them to make their peace with him before it is too late, before the last judgment comes and the sentence is brought down, end quote. You can accept what Jesus did to pay your debt through his death and resurrection, or you can pay your debt. Either way, he says, there is a debt to pay. And he says, settle your accounts before the payment due comes, I guess we could say, right? Now, you may have noticed, and I'm sharing this for points of illustration, right? You may have noticed that the whole thing about student loan forgiveness has come up in the news again, despite the fact that the Supreme Court has already ruled it unlawful, right? You know, it's been ruled unlawful, and we keep finding ways to come back to this and revisiting this again. And some might think, well, what's the big deal? Now, I'm not going to get into the reason why he's doing it and all the politics of that here, but here's what I want you to see. Forgiveness of a debt does not mean that nobody pays it. It only shifts who does. This is why it's a big deal. Right? Because in this case, the taxpayer who may have already paid for their college or not even gone to college or went into the military for the GI Bill to pay for college is being saddled with the debt for somebody else who may have chosen to study something that had no merit whatsoever, right? Now, here's the reason why I'm sharing this point. Why the cross? Because forgiveness of a debt does not mean that nobody pays it. It only shifts who does. That's why Jesus is the biggest crossroads that we come to in life. Because we had a debt to pay. And the question is who's going to pay the debt? This is why the cross was necessary. And this is what separates Christianity from every other religion. Every other religion is based on what do we do to reach God. Christianity is about what God has done to reach us. Why the cross? Because there was a debt to pay. And Jesus said, I'm going to pay the debt for you if you'll accept it. And the point of this final parable is to make friends with Christ, right? That's why this is a unique kind of passage. Make friends with Christ before you stand before the Father. Accept what he's done for you to pay the debt of your sin before God. Now, I realize that most of you who are listening to me, you've already accepted Jesus. You've already come to that crossroad and you've already accepted him and chosen him. But sometimes we need to be reminded of what we already know. So that as we come to new crossroads, as we come to different crisis points, we can remain motivated to praise him, whatever our circumstances may be. Motivated to serve him, whatever the cost may entail. Motivated to follow whatever direction he may lead. Knowing that we may incur worldly cost along the way. Because we do have a world that's divided over Jesus. But while we may incur worldly costs for following him, it is nothing compared to the eternal weight of glory that awaits us in him. 2 Corinthians 4:17. Because every choice comes with a cost. It's a matter of what and a matter of when. And the world around us is changing. And we will be confronted at times with crossroad moments when we have to choose whether we obey God or whether we obey men. We'll have to choose whom we seek to please. So may you know how to interpret the present time and know that whatever the cost of following him may be, it's worth it in the end. Amen. In your bulletin, you have a communication card, and we invite you to think about how God might be speaking to your heart this morning. And then we invite you to offer that up as part of your worship, as part of your next steps. You might think of it as a crossroads moment, right? Thinking about, what is God laying upon my heart, and how am I going to respond to that? As we prepare ourselves for communion and stewardship, Bach writes, we all have debts before God that need paying. To settle accounts with God, we must come to grips with Jesus, because only Jesus can pay our debt. Only Jesus can pay our debt. If there had been any other way to be reconciled to God, then the cross would have been unnecessary. The cross was necessary because we had a debt that we could not pay. And so as we come to this table, we're reminded of what Jesus has done for us. Now, I'm going to be honest. If you want me to see a Facebook post, you have to tag me because I don't scroll through Facebook. But once in a while, something will catch my attention because it's the first thing that pops up when I go to post for the church. And I just happened to see this church sign posted on Facebook. Everything has gone up in price except salvation. It is still a free gift paid in full by Jesus. Forgiveness of a debt doesn't mean that no one pays it. It only shifts who does. Know what Jesus has done for you as you choose now to follow him through your next steps in the stewardship of your life, because you know him whom you have come to believe. So let me remind you that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after he'd given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let us pray. Oh, glorious Father, as we come to this table, we can look at many reasons for which Jesus came. He came to reveal you. He came to teach us truth. He came to seek and to save the lost. He also came to cast fire upon the earth. For we recognize that while Jesus didn't come to condemn the world but to save it, he also says that you're judged and condemned already for not believing. Because one of the things that Jesus does show us is that we were at odds with you, a world in conflict, and we just pray that as we come to this table, we would recognize that we all had a spiritual debt that we could not pay. Help us to embrace what Jesus did to pay our debt so that we might faithfully follow you now. It is in his name that we come. Amen. We invite you to reflect on what Jesus has done for you as you come to partake, and then to think about, well, how do I respond, right? As I think about crossroad moments in my life, how am I responding to him? We invite you to come.
I choose Jesus. There are many things I have chosen in my life. I choose Jesus. And that's how we're going to end today. Would you please stand as you are able, and we'll sing together, I Choose Jesus. Darkness over light.
You know, I usually don't make song suggestions to Amanda. I just, you know, I want to stay out of her business, right?
That's right.
And but this particular week, I told her, I said, you know, I Choose Jesus would be a very appropriate song. And she responded to me with, I was already thinking about that one. You know, may we not go forth with a divided or a wavering response to Jesus, but may we go forth on fire for him. See, there's another use of that word. Do you like how I did that?
Oh.
Because each day will bring us to a new crossroad, won't it? Each day we have the opportunity to choose to be his disciple or to look more like the world around us. So I choose to follow. How about you?